But lovely to see you tonight as we've come to worship God. We recognise his presence. We're going to sing All I Once Held Dear. We'll stand as we worship. As we pray, we give thanks to the Lord. We're also going to remember Francie. Francie retires next Sunday. Next Sunday morning is his last service, although officially it's the end of February. And so after the morning service, we've all been invited to go round for tea and coffee. But tonight we're going to be praying for Francie and Linda as they go into retirement. And let's come before the Lord. Father, we thank you that it's all about knowing you. For when we know you, we know what it is to have life, life everlasting. When we know you, we know what it is to have peace, peace everlasting. And so, Father, we thank you that you've been with us in all that we've been involved with today. Again, Lord, we want to pray for various folk in our congregation in this neighbourhood. Again, Lord, we want to thank you for being with me this afternoon, that opportunity to visit Wilmer and Hilary, Billy Littles, two daughters, as they are thinking and planning for tomorrow. Lord, we thank you that you've been leading and guiding. We thank you, Lord, that you've given them safe journeying mercies as they've come from England and New Zealand. And we pray again that tomorrow your name will be glorified. We pray, Lord, that we might recognize again very clearly who you are and what you've done for us, and that we will not miss that, but we will see it as we read your word and as we sing and as we pray. Father, we come before you too, and we want to thank you for Francie. We thank you for Francie and Linda and how you've been with them over this last 20 years or so. And we thank you for their ministry in Sydenham. We thank you for how you've blessed them in so many ways as they've been faithful, speaking and living and working for you. And we know that our brothers and sisters and some Brendans will see this as a sad occasion next week, as it is Francie's last service. And yet we pray, Lord, that the focus will be on you and totally on you. And we pray, Lord, that Francie and Linda will have a great retirement, that they'll continue to minister for you in lots of different ways. And we want to pray for some Brendans as they go into a time of vacancy, that this will be a time of blessing for them. Lord, it will be a challenge, as any vacancy is, but we pray too that it will be a blessing, and the right man of your choice may be called to serve you with your people here in Sydney. So, Lord, be with them and help them. Give them guidance and give them wisdom as they work with the bishop and the others involved in the vacancy, that it will be evident who the person is that you're calling to work in St. Brendan's. So be with them over the next few weeks and months that lie ahead, that they might know your goodness and your grace. And again, we come before you, and be with us tonight as we sing and as we pray, as we read and as we study, that we will be very conscious that God Almighty is with us, leading us and guiding us. And as we read Jeremiah, Lord, we will understand it, for you, the God who wrote it through Jeremiah, will speak to us through it tonight. So be with us, we ask, for we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Last week, I mentioned the fact that I was hoping to go to the movies on Thursday to see the Exodus. Unfortunately, as I contacted the Odyssey and Dundonald, they're not showing it anymore. It's off. We've just missed the last of it. And so what we're going to do is, as soon as it comes out in DVD, it'll probably be out in another 3-4 months, what we'll do is we'll get the DVD and we'll watch it here in the church some Thursday night. I'm keen for you to see it. I haven't seen it, but some folks say it's very, very good, and other folks say it's absolutely awful. And so it'll be really good for us to look at it, we've just studied it, and for us to consider it. I know that some of you are not sure about that, but it's good for you to assess things, so that when you watch things and hear things, that you assess it according to what the scripture says, rather than, boy, that was a good movie, or that was realistic. I mean, one of the things about the movie, apparently, is God is presented as a little boy. And you think to yourself, what's that about? And what we need to do then is think of how the movie does that, to think what scripture says, and think, why did they do that? And is it right? Is it wrong? Why is it wrong? And we should be doing that with everything that we hear. We should be comparing it, not with what Danny says, but what scripture says. And as we do that, then actually we're able to interact with the things of this world and speak sensibly about the things of this world. It'd be wrong for us to say, oh, I'm not going to see that movie, it's wrong, it's not right. Or it's wrong for us to go and watch the movie and think, is that what really happened? Because both are the extremes and both are wrong. So when it comes out on DVD, we'll have a DVD night. And I promise you, I will get you free popcorn that night. You're going to get free popcorn the night we went to the cinema, but I'll get you free popcorn when you come here. Because I know that Robert McGackie would love to hoover afterwards and sort the place out. So that's what we're planning to do. We are looking at different books of the Bible every fortnight, and hopefully you're starting to read and you've read through your most of Exodus, exciting book. And the other fortnight then we're going through the life of Jeremiah. We decided that we'd do that, or I felt it was right to do that, because Jeremiah is a prophet of God who is very humble, who feels that he's not up for the job, but is willing to be obedient. And he's speaking to a nation who is really not that interested. A nation that used to be great and used to follow God, but has now turned its back on God. And Northern Ireland could be seen maybe as a nation, something like that. We'll read Jeremiah chapter 2 and read the first 15 verses. This is God's word. Jeremiah is speaking and he says, "The word of the Lord came to me. Go and proclaim in the hearing of Jerusalem. I remember the devotion of your youth, how as a bride you loved me and followed me through the desert, through a land not sown. Israel was holy to the Lord, the first fruits of his harvest. All who devoured her were held guilty, and disaster overtook them, declares the Lord. Hear the word of the Lord, O house of Jacob, all the clans of the house of Israel. This is what the Lord says. What fault did your fathers find in me that they strayed so far from me? They followed worthless idols and became worthless themselves. They did not ask, where is the Lord who brought us up out of Egypt and led us through the barren wilderness, through a land of deserts and rifts, a land of drought and darkness, a land where no one travels and no one lives? I brought you to a fertile land to eat its fruit and rich produce. But you came and defiled my land and made my inheritance detestable. The priests did not ask, where is the Lord? Those who deal with the Lord did not know me. The leaders rebelled against me. The prophets prophesied by Baal, following worthless idols. Therefore, I bring charges against you again, declares the Lord. And I will bring charges against your children's children. Cross over the coast of Kinnom and look. Send to Kedar and observe closely. See if there is anything like this. Has a nation ever changed its gods? Yet they are not gods at all. But my people have exchanged their God for worthless idols. Be appalled at this, O heavens, and shudder with great horror, declares the Lord. My people have committed two sins. They have forsaken me, the spring of living water, and they have dug their own citrons, broken citrons that cannot hold water. Is Israel a servant, a slave by birth? Why then has he become plunder? Lions have roared. They have growled at him. They have laid waste his land. His towns are burned and deserted. Amen. Before we look at this passage, a very important passage in the book of Jeremiah, actually. It's his first prophecy. We're going to sing again. It's as the deer pants for the water. This is all about water in this passage, and we'll be singing how the deer pants for that water. What is that water? It's the living water that Christ can bring. Let's stand as we worship. In the 80s, whenever we were living in Thailand was famous above all other countries in the world of being what they call in Thailand Britain Komblom. And what that means is the fake country. You could get anything in Thailand, anything in Thailand. They were great at copying. I think China now is that country. But in the 80s, it was Thailand. And so I was a missionary in Thailand and didn't have 2 cents to rub together. And yet, I always had Nike tops or Gant tops. I had the best of tops. I used to have camel trousers. That's a really expensive make, and all sorts of things. I had a Rolex watch. I had all those things. And it's funny, when I came back from Thailand, because you just buy that watch in the market, you see, and it was Rolex, and I was in home maybe about 18 months, and the battery went in my watch, and I went, there's a wee jeweller's in Corn Market to get a new battery, and took my watch off and said, would you do that for me, put a battery in that? And he said, sure, and he took it away, and he came back 2 minutes, and he said, I'm sorry, I can't give you your watch back. I said, sorry? He says, I'm afraid that's a fake, and I'm not allowed to give your watch back. I said, sorry, what do you mean? He says, sure, that's not a Rolex. I said, oh, no, it wasn't a Rolex. I bought it in a market in Thailand. He says, yes, but I'm not allowed to put a battery in it because it's a fake. And I said, tell you what, just give me my watch back. Don't worry about it. And eventually gave me my watch back, and I went somewhere else and got a battery for it. And because I never thought about it. But they were great at making fakes. Sometimes their fakes was almost never, but almost as good as the real thing. But other times their fakes were awful. There's people who would have bought a watch and 2 days later it fell to bits. And so it looked the part, but it wasn't really the part. And then we came back from Thailand and I realised that Northern Ireland had something similar. We had the Stewart supermarket. In the Stewart supermarket, you could buy yellow pack food. I don't know if you remember yellow pack. So you could buy cornflakes or beans or digestives. Those are 3 things I love. But I only love digestive biscuits, Heinz beans and Kellogg's cornflakes. But Lorraine thought, because we didn't have much money, she'd buy yellow pack cornflakes and yellow pack baked beans and yellow pack digestives. And I couldn't eat them. They were cheap, but they weren't the real thing. That's exactly what this passage is all about. God is calling the people of Israel, and he said, what have you done? Why have you substituted the real thing for the fake? Why have you taken something of quality and you have taken rubbish in its place? Why would you do that? Is there any other nation that would change their gods, he asks. No. And yet you have done that. You have taken the true and living God and you have substituted him for the fake gods, for the gods that don't really work, for the cheap gods that are not gods at all. That's really what this first prophecy of Jeremiah is all about. He's reminding the people what they have done, because they were a wee bit like me when I bought my cheap watch. I knew it was a fake at the time, because you don't buy a Rolex for £2.50. I knew that. But after you wear it for a while, you forget it's a fake. And then again, folk would have said to me when I was back in this country, boy, I like your Rolex. And I always said to them, thank you. I never said to them, well, actually, it cost me £2.50. And it was only when I went to get a new battery in it that I realised it was a fake and it wasn't the right thing. And then I realised, wait a minute, this is a cheap copy. But it was only when I was reminded, and this is what Jeremiah is doing. He's reminding the people of Israel, what you've done is you're worshipping the fakes. And you've been worshipping the fakes for so long that you don't even realise it. So now I'm telling you, don't do it anymore. And the verse that sums up Jeremiah chapter 2 and Jeremiah chapter 3 is when he says, you've taken and you've ignored the true and living God, who is the living waters, and you've built yourselves cisterns of water that are actually broken and no good. That's really the sum of what he's saying in Jeremiah 2 and Jeremiah 3. They've substituted the real thing for the fake. Why would they have done that? That was a crazy thing to do. And the reason they did it is interesting because, unfortunately, the clue is in the word when he's talking about this cistern that they built. It's their cistern. In other words, it's what they have built. It's what they have done. In other words, they've ignored what God has offered and they've built their own thing. You see, there's a cost in coming to drink of the living water. And initially you think, well, is there a cost? Remember when Isaiah is speaking? And Isaiah speaks just before Jeremiah. He's speaking probably maybe 50, 60 years before Jeremiah. And he says, come to the living water. Come, those who are thirsty. Come without price and drink from the living water, Isaiah says. Come and listen to the God, the true and living God, the Lord God Almighty. Come to the living water and drink. That's what Isaiah is saying. And Jesus repeats that in John. It says, I am the living water. If you're thirsty, come and drink without cost. Come to me, he says. And yet there's a cost with that. There's a cost. The water itself is free, but there's a cost. And the cost is this. You have to come. You have to make the conscious decision to go and drink of the water. And you have to listen to the true and living God. And the idea behind listening is not what James is saying, those people who look in the mirror and as soon as they turn away, they forget. But the idea of listening in Isaiah and what Jesus is saying is listening and obeying. So that's why the people built their own water. Again, one time in Thailand, I was there maybe about 6 months, and I was in this village. We had tap water in our house that worked most of the time. But we filtered the water before we drank it. But when you went out to the villages, they didn't have tap water. They got water from the river. And in the summertime, their hot season, which is April and May, the river is almost dry. And so what they do is they collect water in these big urns, big earthenware urns, and then they put a lid on it. And they use that. So when it's the rainy season, they collect these water, and then they store them for the hot season where the river doesn't work. When it's dry. And I remember, I was always told, if you go out to a village and they give you something to eat or drink, whatever it is, you eat it. And some of the things I've eaten, you would hardly believe. But I was sitting in this house one day, and they offered me water. And she lifted the water, and she put it in the glass, the lid. And when she held the water, it was cloudy. And not only was it cloudy, you could see lots of wee things swimming in the inside of it. And I thought, the best thing to do is just get it down me. And I drank it, knowing rightly for the next few days that I wouldn't be well. And for the next week and a half, I wasn't well, big time. But it was the only water they had. And really what Jeremiah is saying, that's the water you're drinking. You can have the living water that is fresh and pure, or you can drink this water that is stale and stagnant and off. And the people have chosen to drink that. Because they weren't willing to come. And he points back to the history. He says, look, remember in Egypt, when I brought you out of Egypt, he talks about that, what we read in Exodus. He says that even then, although the people followed God at first, they begin to change. And then he goes on to mention three groups of people who have turned away from him. He mentions the priests. The priests, the people who are supposed to intercede for the people to God. And they, the priests, turn and worship the Baals, worship the other gods. So those who were supposed to bring the people to God, they turned away. And then he mentions the rulers are the people who are supposed to bring God's justice to God's people. And they turn aside to worship other gods. And then he talks about the priests. The priests are supposed to bring God's word to the people. And he tells us here in chapter 2 that the priests speak the words of Baal rather than the words of God Almighty. So in every sector of the people, they've turned away from God. They've turned away from the true and living God, and they've worshipped gods that don't even exist. So here is a nation that is completely turned away. And the reason for that is they aren't willing to come and speak to God, to hear God speak to them in God's terms. In other words, they wanted gods that fitted into their pockets. They wanted gods that would do the things that they want them to do. They wanted to manipulate their gods so that they would have the weather that wanted, that they would have the wealth that they wanted, and that they would have the health that they wanted. That's the gods they wanted. They wanted to make the gods suit them. Whereas when we come to God, we need to come in God's terms, and they weren't willing to do that. And we live in a society that's exactly the same. Wealth is one of the gods that we worship. The important people in our society are those who are wealthy. The people who are on our TV screens are those that have got money. And they can do things. Those people who can buy their way into places. The rich people at the minute are the Russians. Apparently they're buying up many parts of London, all the expensive houses in London. They're buying those houses up. That's why the house market in London has shot way up, because most of the houses are bought by Russians. And what they're doing is they're buying the house and leaving the house empty. So they're not renting it out, and therefore there's a whole problem with getting rented houses in London, and part of that is because there's many, many empty houses, and those empty houses are bought by Russians. And they only buy it so that another 3 or 4 years they can sell it again, and they don't want the hassle of renting it out, and there's a real problem in Russia, in London over that at the minute. But money speaks and money talks, and in our society money is important. Money is a god. If you have money, you're happy. If you have no money, you're not happy. You talk to people and they'll always say, if I just had enough to get by, and that means a good holiday and a good home and good clothes and good food. And people always want that wee bit more. You talk to everybody who does the lottery. Not that I've talked to everybody, but they will have the same answer. And the answer is, if I win the lottery, this is what I'll do. In other words, the money spent in their heads with the money they're going to get from the lottery. And the idea they spend their £2 or £5 or £10 because it's in their head. I was talking to the chap across the road there, and there's people who spend £50 a week on scratch cards because they've got the money spent in their heads. Money, money, money is a god of our generation. It's a god in our society. Another god in our society, that we turn away from the true and living God as a society to worship, is that of power. Power is important to people in our society. It's being in a place where you can tell people what to do. People love that. And that's why you have Westminster and you have Stormont and you've got local government, and we're trying to make our local government smaller, and there's lots of people complaining about that because people are losing their positions of power and influence, and people want to have power. One of the big problems with the paramilitary organisations after the peace process started is that they had a sense that they lost their power. And so many of the people in the paramilitaries, whether it's one side or the other, went into community work. And the reason they did that was to try and maintain some sort of power within the community. And they've branched out to other areas to try and have power within the community. And it's all to do with power. Those with power have influence. Those with influence are important. Wealth and power and prestige, this idea of being famous. Everybody wants to be famous, and people will do anything to be famous. You only have to watch YouTube and see some of the daft things people do so they can have their moment of fame. All you have to do is watch X Factor or Britain Got Talent. You see these people come on. I can't watch it anymore, but when it was first on, I thought it was hilarious. But it's just too much now. People will come on Britain's Got Talent or X Factor, and they will sing. And they sing like Danny Rankin. There is no way that they think that they are singers. I know, well, I can hear a good singer. I can hear whether someone's in tune or not. But when I sing, it is awful. And sometimes when my kids were smaller, they would have said, Dad, you're pretending to sing that bad. And I used to think, if only I was pretending to sing that bad. I can't sing. And yet there's people who do that on the X Factor and all those programs because they want to be seen on television. Because prestige is important. We make people like footballers really important. We make people like film stars more important. We make people in television programs really important because they happen to be on Coronation Street or Emmerdale or EastEnders. Or sometimes they read the news sometimes, and therefore we think they're really important. And we do these things because they're little gods, you know, the god of wealth and the god of power and the god of prestige. Those things we people aim at and they focus on because that's what they want, and they're not willing to come to the true and living God. And he tells us we need to come to him. We need to make that conscious effort to come to him. And we need to listen to him. In other words, when he speaks, we hear what he says and we need to obey it. And the problem with the people of Israel for the last 200-300 years is they did not come to God. They'd rather go to the false gods because they weren't willing to listen to God, to hear him speak and obey. And so Jeremiah is reminding him of that again. He says, this is what the problem is. You've turned from the true and living God and you're following gods that are not gods at all. And what's happening, Jeremiah, is exactly what happened today, is happening today. How do we get round that? Well, we're going to look at Jeremiah, and we're going to actually look as far as the people were concerned and the outcome were concerned. He was a failure. Now, he was a great success because he was faithful, and success is about being faithful and not about seeing nations turned around. I appreciate that. But I think because we're living in a similar situation, we have an advantage that he doesn't have. And the advantage is that each one of us are filled with the Holy Spirit. Jeremiah was filled with the Holy Spirit, and when he was speaking, it was a lone voice. But each one of us who are born again of the Spirit of God have the Holy Spirit within us. And therefore, it's not that it's one Jeremiah speaking, but it's 10, it's 20, it's 40, it's 100. And therefore, we can see a change in our society if we are a people of prayer and a people of purpose and a people who are willing to speak and to preach in the name of God. That's the difference between us and the time of Jeremiah. Jeremiah was one lone voice. There was Zephaniah, was the only one in his time who spoke out in the name of God. Apart from those two, every priest had turned his back. Every ruler had turned his back. And every prophet, apart from those two prophets, had turned their back on God. And yet they remained faithful. And in that reason, he was a great success. So we, the people of God, as we go into this world that worship other gods, it's up to us to tell them how foolish that is. That's what he's saying there. He says, would you rather drink from a pool of water that's dirty? If I had that big tank of water, that big urn of water that I had in Gampang Pet, and if I give you a glass of that water, would you drink it? You'd be foolish to drink it. It's water, like a glass of water from the living tap, from a good tap. It's the same thing. But what's the difference? The difference is full of muck. It's full of things that are harmful for you. And therefore, it's up to us this week as we speak to people that we try to bring people to their senses through the work of the Holy Spirit. And we help them recognize that worshipping money or worshipping power or worshipping prestige or fame is of little importance when one day we'll need to meet the true and living God. Let's pray together. Father, we come again to your word. We read it and we are amazed how relevant it is to our lives nowadays. This was written nearly 2,600 years ago. And yet, Lord, as we read it, it's like a commentary on life in Northern Ireland in 2015. He explains the problem very, very clearly. And Lord, the problem we have is exactly the same. We were a nation, Northern Ireland were known to be a country who followed God. Per capita, it was the most generous country in the world, given to missions. Per capita, it was the highest percentage of people who went off to the mission field in the whole of the world. There was no other country that sent more missionaries abroad per capita than Northern Ireland. We were known to be Christian. And yet when we look at our society today, we realise they've stopped drinking from the living water. And they're drinking from the hot water tanks. They're drinking from the pools with stagnant water that's full of germs. They're following gods who are not gods at all. We can see that, Lord. Help us not to be condemning in our language, but help us to explain it to our family and our friends and those that we come across, the danger that they're in by turning away from the true and living God, and the possibility they have of coming back to drink from the living water of the Lord God Almighty. Help us to be bold and wise this week, for we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Our final hymn then is an encouragement for us to go forward in your name. But yes, we don't want to forget the offering, do we? Let's contain so much of God. Let's present to God our offering. It's time for us to arise and sing, "Soldiers of Christ, Arise." Let's stand as we worship.
Thank you.
And then with the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit, rest and reign with each one of us now and forevermore. Amen. Just to see, I was in contact with Peter Love today, and Peter says that the Keep Fit on Tuesday will go ahead. So, okay.